About concept called epsilon regularity. So we said that a bipartite graph between two parts is epsilon regularity if it's uniform in the sense that whichever not too small set we take, the density between them is almost uniform, almost close to T. And this concept was useful because of two reasons. First, regularity lemma asserts that no matter what graph we have, so we have large graph, then we can partition the vertices set into bounded number of clusters. We call this vertex set a cluster, which has all the same size, V1, V2, V3, V4, and most of the pairs are epsilon regular. And here we have small number of exceptional vertices. And we define what's called reduced graph, which is each cluster we shrink it into one vertex. And then if it's epsilon regular with certain density above some delta, so epsilon delta reduced graph, is that if this pair is epsilon regular with density at least delta, then we add an edge, then this is R, so which is useful to analyze this epsilon regular partition. And it inherits some property of original graph G, so by analyzing R, we know certain information about this epsilon regularity partition and the original graph. So this says that essentially every graph every large graph admits certain epsilon regularity partition, epsilon regularity structure. And then the other reason is embedding lemma. The other reason why this concept is useful for this graph embedding problem is that the embedding lemma, we prove that when we have a H which has bounded maximum degree and it has say x1, x2, x3, it's partitioned into several independent sets, and G is epsilon regular with V1, V2, V3, so this is epsilon regular, epsilon regular, epsilon regular. And this has size roughly, each xi has size roughly at most epsilon n, and each bi has size n. Then we can embed h into g. So that's what we learned yesterday. And then yesterday afternoon we learned about the case, we started thinking about the case when h has same size as g, both as n vertex. So, now, so here we have this additional constraint that the H should be sufficiently smaller than N. But if we can weaken it so that if we can allow that each Xi has size N, then that would be very good for us. We can use this scheme of proof, using regularity lemma and applying embedding lemma. So that was the way of proving this graph embedding problems yesterday in morning. But if we can strengthen this embedding lemma into here, so allowing H to have an N vertex, then we can apply the same way of proving to problems regarding large graph embedding, both in the case that both have the N vertices. But the simplest case for that is when H is a matching, consists of n edges, and G consists of n vertices, so this is n vertices, and epsilon D regular. But already yesterday we checked that it doesn't have to embed it into this epsilon regular pair, because there could be isolated vortices for what we know. But yesterday we checked that however if we enforce one more condition, if we add one more condition of minimum degree, then this perfect matching actually embeds into this G. So maybe what we hope for is that epsilon regularity is not enough, but if we add some minimum degree condition, then maybe we can hope for improving the condition into, spanning copy of H, the H when H has n vertices. So from that motivation, we define the notion of epsilon superregularity. So, which is just the epsilon regularity plus some minimum degree condition, which is exactly what we imagined before. So let G be a graph and a joint pair AB of vertices, of sets of vertices. Epsilon D superregular. If it is epsilon D plus regular, so epsilon regular with the density at least some number bigger than D, and all the vertices in A has a number of neighbors in B at least D minus epsilon times B, and all the vertices in B has the at least T minus epsilon times A many neighbors in the other side for all A and B. So what we showed last time is that with that condition, we can actually embed the perfect matching into this epsilon regular epsilon D super regular pair. And indeed, we can do more than that. Which one's the paper that I was looking? Anyway, here, okay. Yep. So, we can actually. So this is the concept that which is epsilon regular and some minimum degree condition. And indeed, we can improve this embedding lemma into something stronger, which we will call blob lemma. So let's write here. I will start writing fold here so that it can stay here for a while. So we say it is a blob lemma. So here, blob, what blob means is that when we take the vertices and say we have this graph, and then we replace this one vertex by an independent set, and replace one vertex by independent set, replace one vertex by independent set, and add all the edges. So it's complete bipartite, complete bipartite. We call it a blob of this graph. Yeah? So we call it blob lemma because we have, say, H looks in this way, and then G is epsilon superregular. Then when when we consider embedding of H into G, then this G actually behaves like this complete bipartite graph, so this is actually blob. So we can embed this H into this G as if G was this blob. If H has bounded maximum degree, and this was epsilon D superregular. That's the motivation for this naming. It's what I guess. Never actually someone explicitly told me that was the reason, but yeah. So what it says is essentially the same as the embedding lemma before. So suppose we have n, which is big. So we assume n is big. And epsilon is also smaller than other parameter. So what this rigorously means is that for given R, D, delta, there exists epsilon 0, so that for all epsilon smaller than epsilon 0, the following statement holds. And for given those four pairs, there is N0 such that if N is bigger than N0, then the following holds. So let H be a N vertex graph. So here I wrote that H be a vertex graph, okay, which is a typo again. N vertex graph with vertex partition x1 to xr,
so which are. Do you also mean that epsilon is a less smaller than d?
Yes, r, d, delta, so whatever epsilon is a less smaller. Yep, so all of them. Yep. Yeah, that's. Yeah, right. With maximum degree of h bounded. So each xi is an independent set in H. And let G be a graph with vertex partition P1, PR, P1 to PR, such that each PI and each XI has all size N. And PI, PJ is epsilon D super regular.
Sorry, H is an N vertex graph.
Ah, sorry. Oh, yeah, that's why I deleted N. Okay, at first I wrote it that way, and then later. Let's say that is a graph, and these all have size N. Sorry. Yep. For all distinct I and J. Then there is an embedding pi of H into G such that all XI map into BI. So this is exactly what embedding lemma says. So if we have H, which is partitioned to x1, x2, x3, and there is h, 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 so this is a bounded degree graph. And we have b1, b2, b3, which are epsilon d superregular, epsilon d superregular, epsilon d superregular, this is g, h. And even if all of the sets have the same size, we can embed H into G. So I will not provide a proof of this, but there are two ways to prove it. One is generalizing the proof of embedding lemma. So how do we do it? We embed one by one, right? And then when we embed one vertex, we care about the candidate sets for other vertices. And we want to show that it doesn't shrink too much. That was the proof of embedding lemma. But when we choose one specific, when we embed one vertex, we choose one of the good vertices. So there are bad vertices which shrink too much, and we just choose one of the any arbitrary good vertex. But we can further add more element. So out of good choices, you choose one at random. Then you can ensure that not only the candidate doesn't shrink too much, but it shrink in very close to expected, ratio. So you keep do that until by doing that you can, strengthen the embedding lemma. So embedding lemma embeds epsilon n vertices into n vertices. But by doing that you can actually strengthen it so that we can embed 1 minus epsilon n vertices into n. And then at the later, small number of vertices left. And then for that small number of vertices, because of the randomness, you do it before, you can show that the holds condition holds at the end with a small number of vertices to remaining, I mean, unembedded vertices. The, then you can, I mean, embed them at the end one at once. So that's one way to prove it. And another way to prove it is, so we, yesterday we learned that the perfect matching embeds into this superregular graph. So if you have a bounded degree graph, and then this superregular graph, this bounded degree graph, I mean, by using some theorem in, I mean, like something like Heiner's homology or something, but what we can do is we can further partition it so that these are matching. We can actually, because this has bounded degree graph, we can partition it in this way. So basic idea is this is H, then we consider H square, which is that if two vertices are distance 2, then we add an H, and then there we find the proper coloring. Then in proper coloring, it is proper coloring means that there are no this kind of vertices. If this is red, then this doesn't happen. So by using that coloring, we can find this kind of coloring that between the color class, we only have matching. But I mean, it is not really important, but we kind of decompose this graph into matching. And then here we decompose it in the similar way, and we embed this matching into this superregular graph, matching into superregular graph. But of course, it is not that simple, but I mean, basically, by that approach, we can also prove it. So this is not important. So I just gave you the basic idea of how we can prove it. But as long as you understand what this means, then that is enough for now. So this is essentially the same with embedding lemma, but we can allow for a spanning copy of H. So H could have the same size as G. So this is actually a simplified version of more complicated statement. So let me add some remarks, because we will use a stronger version of this in the afternoon. So one thing is that here we said that all the xi has the same size and all the vi has the same size, which is n. But that's not really necessary. We can just say that xi and vi has size ni, and which is large enough. This is okay. So if you think about the proof of embedding lemma, we never actually use that, size of vi's are all same. So even if they are different, the proof still goes through. So we can allow them to have different size, as long as they are large. And second is that here, we said that every pair is epsilon D superregular, right? But that's not really necessary if, say, H looks this way and there is no H, then there is no need for, I mean, this pair to be superregular. As long as this is superregular, then it is also okay. So in other words, so the reduced graph of this epsilon superregular partition doesn't have to be complete. So non-complete reduced graph is okay if, how do I write? If H between Xi and Xj is empty, for ij not in the reduced graph. So that's exactly, so in G, this is reduced graph, so this is not H. So A in H, so in H, X1, X2, X3, there should be no H here, because we don't have superregularity here. So that's what it means. And one drawback of this theorem is this relation. The number of parts and epsilon should be smaller. But if you recall regularity lemma, what do you do? We take epsilon first, and then we apply regularity lemma, and we obtain partition. And the number of parts, R, was bounded by some function of epsilon. So R could be much bigger than epsilon. So in regularity lemma, what we get is actually this relation. But our aim was to apply regularity lemma first, and then apply Bloch lemma later. So we want to use both together, but this is our obstacle, because we cannot use them together.
And regularity lemma also doesn't give you super regularity.
Yeah, that's another drawback. Yeah, so those two are the main obstacle for applying those two together. So for that, what actually we can do is, this is not really necessary. As long as we have epsilon is much smaller than 1 over delta of this R for reduced graph R. So here it was complete reduced graph. Reduced graph was complete. That was our assumption. So maximum degree of reduced graph and number of vertices in reduced graph, which is R, is off by 1. So they are essentially the same thing. But reduced graph could be something like this, say, cycle. So these are super regular, these are super regular, these are super regular, these are super regular, these are super regular. Then this has maximum degree 2. So in that case, no matter how many parts we have, we can apply Bloch lemma. So with this, we can overcome one of the problem applying regularity lemma and Bloch lemma together. We apply regularity lemma, we get a large partition. There, we have this reduced graph, R, which has large size or and also maximum degree is large. But we don't have to use them all. We can just take a subgraph of this reduced graph, which has bounded maximum degree. And then we use that to apply the Bloch lemma. Yeah. And to make the regular, epsilon regular into super regular, we will do something later.
So it's okay to have
subgraph
of reduced graph?
Yes, so we can just delete. So we have H and G, right? We want to embed it. But if we embed into subgraph of G, then that's okay, also okay. So we just delete some pairs, all the edges in the pair. Then you get, sparser, reduced graph. And then in there, we try to embed it. And then last, fourth remark, is that we can specify, okay, for, let's write it this way, for its I and vertex that say x prime I, which is subset of xi, with its size is at most epsilon n. So for each xi, there is this small set. Then we can roughly specify the image pi of x for each this x inside of this x prime I. What it means is, let's write it here. So x1, say x2, x3, v1, v2, v3. And then let's say we have this, say, three vertices. And then, so in when we embed this into here, this into here, this into here, these three vertices are some special vertex, so that we want to embed the first vertex into one of these vertex. And second vertex into one of these vertex. And third vertex into, say, one of these vertex. And this set has size at least, say, some, I didn't specify, some linear size set, say, alpha n. Then alpha should go into here. So still, epsilon is much smaller than alpha. Then we can do. That means that these vertices are embedded here, and these vertices are embedded here, these vertices are embedded here. In, on top of that, this one is inside of this red, I mean, blue set. This two is inside of this red set. This three is inside of this white set. That we can do. As long as, so here three is very small number, right? As long as we specify at most epsilon n vertices.
By specify, you mean you have
one of them. One of these linearly many vertices.
So you can give some list.
Yeah, give some list. Linear size list, and it's allowed to go into one of these, but not other. So this is, this board is useful. We will actually use it. Because, assume that the, if we can just apply Bloch lemma once and get an embedding, then that would be fantastic. But lots of cases, life is not that simple. So what we have to do is, sometimes, some vertices, we have to embed it first before applying Bloch lemma. Let's say we have this. This graph. And then let's say we already embedded this x into v. So this is pi of x. We already embedded. We decide that we will embed into here. And then we want to apply the Bloch lemma to the left. Then where this vertex should go to? So in H, so now it's deleted, it's already embedded, so there is no H in the this A, in this smaller subgraph H prime. But if we just embed it, then we are never guaranteed to have this H embedded into this H. So how do we do it is we take its neighbor here. And then we specify that this vertex should go into this set. And then we apply Bloch lemma. Then this H is not in H. So this entire thing is H, and the deleted one is H prime, and we apply Bloch lemma to H prime. But by specifying this set, we can automatically get this H is embedded to this H. So is it clear? So that's the purpose of this four. So essentially what it means is that there are small number of vertices. We already specify where it should go. And then using this trick, we can extend this partial embedding into the embedding that we want. So this, oh yeah, here. So now, okay. So that's how we will apply Bloch lemma. But as Sangil mentioned, there is one more obstacle. When you apply regularity lemma, it only gives epsilon the regular pair, not super regular. But for us to be able to use Bloch lemma, we need super regular pair. So there are some techniques that we can use, which are exercise 6.2, 6.3, 6.4. So 6.2 essentially says that when you have a regular pair, epsilon deregular, then what we know is that so before in section 4 we prove an exercise showing that most of the vertices here has the right degree. And most of the vertices here has the right degree. So if you take the vertices with two small degree, then the size is small. And we can just delete it. Then the remaining graph has enough minimum degree because this has size, small size. So we can enforce the minimum degree condition by deleting those vertices. And also, because we delete small number of vertices, its epsilon regularity doesn't get too worse. It might become 2 epsilon d, but still, it satisfies certain regularity condition. So, there exists a prime and b prime, small, with size, say, less than epsilon a and epsilon b, such that this a minus a prime and b minus b prime is superregular, epsilon superregular. So we can delete some vertices and we can make the remaining part superregular. So that's what exercise 6.2 says. And 6.3 says that so this means that there exists some sets that we can delete to make it superregular. And then while you're making it superregular, we might have to delete, so that is superregular. So we made it superregular. And then now this is regular, so we have to delete more to make it superregular. But once we delete it, we hope that this superregularity is not ruined. So when we make this superregular, and then if this becomes ruined, then we are not good. So what it says is that if we have epsilon superregular, and for all a prime, b prime small, if we delete it, then this is still superregular. With slightly worse epsilon. So every time we do this, the epsilon gets worse. But as long as we don't do it too much time, it is still okay. Because epsilon was initially small. So initially we picked it much smaller than we need. Then by doing that, we don't get ruined. It doesn't get ruined too much. And exercise 6.4 says that we can repeatedly apply 6.3 so that when we have a reduced graph, so when you have this epsilon regular partition, and then say R is reduced graph with small maximum degree, then we can make all the pairs superregular by repeatedly applying 6.3 while we don't delete too much. Here this condition is necessary because we cannot keep applying 6.3 to make the whole reduced graph with high degree superregular, because we know that, let's say B1, B2, B3, BR. We know that R is much bigger than epsilon, right? So if we make this superregular, we delete epsilon n vertices here. Epsilon, say, this is size n over r vertices here. And to make this superregular, we have to delete another epsilon n over r. So we keep do that, then how much edges we deleted? Epsilon n. How much vertices we deleted? Epsilon n, but which is much bigger than n over r. So we might have to delete all of them, which is too much. So this condition is needed. So we repeatedly apply 6.3, then we get 6.4. So, and one more thing I want to mention is that previously in section 4, one of the exercises says that when we have a epsilon regular partition, we can also add small number of vertices. Because small number of vertices, whatever we do, this epsilon regularity doesn't get affected too much if this is small. Epsilon might be get worse, but so we can also freely add vertices without ruining regularity. Then super regularity is just regularity plus minimum degree condition. So essentially, let's say this was super regular, and we add some vertices here, and we know that they all have large number of neighbors here. We don't know how, but each vertex has a large number of neighbors here. And here also, every vertex has a large number of neighbors here. Then resulting partition is still super regular with slightly worse parameter. So this provides whole set of modification we can apply to this epsilon regular partition. So by using this, our goal is when we have an epsilon regular partition, we have this reduced graph R. And in R, we take R prime, which is subgraph of R, which has bounded maximum degree. We will use those, epsilon regular pairs that's in R prime. And then we make these modifications to make them super regular. And then we apply Bloch lemma. So that's our idea of how we will use regularity lemma and Bloch lemma together. So let's try one example. So we will do one easy example and then one difficult example. So one easy example, hopefully we can finish it in 30 minutes. And then we will start the difficult example, and then we will hopefully finish at the end of today.
What do you do with the V0, the first part?
Yes, so I mentioned that we can actually add some vertices to make it still, while preserving some super regularity, right? So when we want to get spanning copy, n vertex graph, we have to deal with that vertices in exceptional set. But in our situation, we enforce some minimum degree condition in G. So we know that every vertex in that exceptional class, every exceptional vertex, it has large degree. So we can find the specific class so that this vertex has enough neighbor. Then we can add it to its counterpart. Then this super regularity is not ruined. Since the number of exceptional vertices is small, if we distribute it well, then we can make sure that the added vertices are not too big. So that's how we will do. So first we will do some easy example, which is in the case that H is not spanning. So H has slightly less number of vertices than N, then life gets much easier. We can, for example, we can throw away exceptional vertices, because exceptional vertices has only epsilon n vertices. And if we assume that H has, say, 1 minus epsilon, 1 minus 100 epsilon times n vertices, then we can throw away small vertices, right? So life gets easier. So I will show you one of such example. And for that, I will introduce some history and theorem. Probably not history, but yesterday we proved a Heinrich Emoretti theorem, which says that if H is disjoint union of complete graph, and we have G, then it shows that minimum degree of G is at least 1 minus 1 over K, say that's case of K, times N, then H embeds into G. Right? So what if we have not disjoint union of KK, but say disjoint union of this kind of thing, some other graph? then what would be the minimum degree condition? So this theorem was known as Alon-Euster conjecture. So for given, say, F vertex graph F with chromatic number K, then there exists N0, so if N is large, so if G is on M vertex graph, with minimum degree at least 1 minus 1 over k times n plus some constant, there exists n0 nc. And if f divides n, then g contains, let's just write it this way, then G contains N over F floor cup disjoint union of vertex disjoint union of F. So what it says is that in that this case, this is three chromatic. So the triangle case, this was the threshold. But this case, this is almost like triangle. We just add some constant and that's enough. So this was known as the Alon-Euster conjecture. And later, Komrosch, Sarkozy, same already proved it using Bloch lemma. And later, Kuhn and Ostwith further improved this. So this further improved this into a better theorem. So for example, this is three chromatic graph. But let's say other graph, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay, this is another three chromatic graph. But in some sense, this is more chromatic, more close to bipartite. This is three chromatic, but, oh, I mean, just because of one, I mean, you know what I'm saying, right? So if we consider this and this, then the, this and this separately, then this threshold should be different. So this is for three chromatic, and this is for bipartite. There should be, if we consider one graph by one graph, then they should, there should be some graph between them, right? So later, Kuhn and Ostwith, I mean, specify for each graph what is the correct threshold, which is actually between this 1 minus 1 over chromatic number and 1 minus 1 over chromatic number minus 1. But, yeah.
Which means that this theorem is not tight, right? I mean,
this theorem is tight in the sense that there exists a graph, K chromatic graph, which gives us equality. But if we consider graph by graph, then there are graphs which are not tied with this.
Uh-huh. Yeah. I see. So for fixed F, this is not tied, right?
Yeah, for fixed F, this might not be tied. So this is still too complicated to prove it with directly with the Bloch lemma. So we will prove a weakening of this. So same setup. Yeah, I will just say same setup. And this G has slightly higher minimum degree. So, and for given alpha and the f and same. So minimum degree slightly higher, so we add the additional linear term, so which is weaker degree. Then G contains 1 minus alpha times n over f vertex disjoint f. So we have a stronger minimum degree condition, and we don't want to get the maximum number of disjoint union, disjoint vertex disjoint copies of f, only almost all of them. So this is, we are considering embedding of H into G when H has only 1 minus epsilon, 1 minus alpha times n vertices, so not spanning. So that makes our life much easier. So proof. So first, let f prime be a disjoint union of k copies of f, and let x1 to xk be a partition of vertices in f prime, so that all the vertices have the same size. So f has a, f is k chromatic. That means it can be partitioned into k independent sets, but some of them might have bigger size, some of them might have smaller size. Then it's difficult to deal with it, because we have this freedom that in the sense that we don't have to embed the, I mean, we don't have to use all the vertices, so it is convenient to take the disjoint union of f so that we can have this partition into independent set. So for example, if we have, say, so two vertex here, one vertex here, say three vertex here, this is f. And what you do is we take one copy of f, and second copy, we say that here we have one vertex and two vertex and three vertex. Same copy, you just rotate it. And then here one vertex and two vertex and three vertex, and you rotate it. And then you take a disjoint union, and this is x1, x2, x3, then every vertex has six vertices. Every set has six vertex.
So you want xi to be independent?
Yep, independent. The partition of that into independent set. Yeah. So instead of embedding f, now we can just consider f prime, which has this nice partition into independent set with the same size. And so we consider epsilon and t, let's say t is epsilon to the negative 2, just some number. And we assume that 1 over n0 is smaller than epsilon delta alpha 1 over k 1. So for given alpha and k, we choose some number. So alpha and k is given from the statement. Alpha is given and k is given. F is given, so f, the chromatic number of f is given. So this is given number. And for this given number, we choose very small delta. That's our choice. And also, epsilon is what we can choose. Yeah, epsilon is not here. Okay, so epsilon, we choose very small number. And then n0 is something we can choose, right? We said that for given alpha and k, there exists epsilon, so we can take there is n0, sorry. There is n0, so we can take n0 as small as we want. So smaller than, much smaller than this, much smaller than this, much smaller than this. So in more rigorous notion, for this there exists delta, so that for these three, there exists epsilon, and for these four, there exists n0. But that's not intuition. That's unintuitional, right? So this way is, you get more intuition. So we choose in this way. And we apply regularity lemma. Lemma to G to obtain B0, B1, BR. And we know that R is between epsilon to the negative 2 and to at most some T, which is a function of epsilon. But which is much smaller than N0. Because N0 we chose it, we saw epsilon and then we choose N0. So the N0 was much bigger. And consider epsilon delta reduced graph R. And let M be the size of Bi for I at least one. So we know that the B0 is exceptional class, so special one, but everything else has the same size. Let's say that's M. Then we know that this M is, say, okay, let me do it this way. And one thing we can assume is that R is divisible by K. K divides R. So why we can do it is if that doesn't happen, we take at most K classes here and then just move them to B0. Yeah, because we are just considering non-spanning graph. That doesn't make much difference. And all the condition regarding this regularity partition still holds. With epsilon replaced by 2 epsilon, say. Before, this has size at most epsilon, but because of this movement, it might have a slightly bigger size, but less than 2 epsilon n. And then the other condition, like for each one cluster, almost all of them, almost all pairs with the others are epsilon regular. And because we deleted some, the fractional of the non-epsilon regular partition was only epsilon r, but because of deletion, r changes, so it might become at most 2 epsilon r, but that doesn't change anything. So we assume that k divides r. Then, what do we know? We have in exercise 4.6. What it says is that if we consider this reduced graph R, then R inherits certain property of the original graph G. One of them was minimum degree condition, which says that if, say, minimum degree of G was, say, at least some dn, then minimum degree of R is at most d minus, say, 2 delta R. So that's what this exercise 4.6 says. So this delta is from this epsilon delta reduced graph delta. So the decrement of this minimum degree constant is dependent on this delta. But we know that delta is smaller than alpha. That's how we chose. So we have this minimum degree of R is at least 1 minus 1 over K plus alpha minus 2 delta times R. And alpha is much bigger than delta, so this is, we can say, alpha over 2. Then once we have it, what can you say? So, yesterday we already proved Heinrich's Emoretti theorem. So, by Heinrich's Emoretti, what we have. Yep. On another way, that's the embedding of this disjoint union of complete graph, right? So what I mean is the complement version. So because of that minimum degree condition, Heinrich's Emoretti theorem implies that the n over k copies, not n, r over k copies of complete graph on k vertices embeds into R. So in other words, say K3, then we have this epsilon regular and epsilon regular partition. So we can group them so that these are epsilon regular, these are epsilon regular, these are epsilon regular. There could be epsilon regular between, but we don't care. Then each of these is small, only has size k. So by the modification we explained, exercise 6.4, we can delete small number of vertices, and then make all pairs superregular. And we can take small number of vertices and delete. We can take small number of vertices, delete, and then we can make it superregular. So let's say this R prime is this subgraph, which is R prime is subgraph of R. So for this corresponding one, we add H, and for this corresponding one, we add H. Then this R prime has maximum degree k minus 1. So by exercise 4 with 6.4 with R prime, we can find, say, UI subset of BI. So the remaining one is UI with size M prime. And after deletion, if they have the different size, we can arbitrarily delete some more vertices to make them have all the same size. So we know that if we delete arbitrarily small number of vertices, that doesn't affect the epsilon regularity too much. So all of them has M prime, which is say 1 minus 3k epsilon n over R. We can ensure that. And each ui, uj is say 6k epsilon times delta superregular.
When they are in the same group, right?
Oh yeah, with ij in this r prime. So we take, let F double prime be the disjoint union of, M prime over size of F prime disjoint union of F prime. So we take F prime and many copies so that the number of this many copies. Then that F double prime looks pretend that f double prime has this partition so that each of them has size smaller than m prime. So this many different union of copy of f prime, f double f prime. So say xi. So all the xi has the same size. So that many different union of that, then each part, so we put all the x1 together. X1 from first copy of f prime and x1 of second copy of f prime and then so on. So and each this partition, each part has size at most m prime. And then if we take one of these triangular superregular pair, then this size is exactly m prime. It's m prime. M prime. And superregular. So we apply Bloch lemma to embed this into here. So apply Bloch lemma. Yeah, I should have drawn it there. Yeah. Lemma to embed f prime into its, say, its g of union v sub I. I is in, say, vertex of k sub k, or its k sub k in r prime. Then that give us vertex disjoint copies of f in G. And in order to count how many copies of f we have embedded, let's just count the vertices which are not covered. And at most, say, so V0 has epsilon n vertices, which is never covered. And then we have deleted some vertices in V sub I. So we take at most k of them, we deleted. So at most k times n over r vertices, which is not covered. And because this could have slightly less size than m prime. But because of this, the number of vertices not embedded here are at most size of xi, which is at most k times f, no, at most f. And all of how many parts are there? So here f vertex. So that means f vertex. So f times r. This is constant. This is some k over r. And r is much bigger than epsilon to the negative 2. That was our choice. And this is epsilon n. So all together, this is at most 2 epsilon n, which is smaller than, oh yeah, I forgot one. And then, so each one of them, we make it superregular. So we deleted these vertices, right? That was how much? 3k epsilon proportion. So 3k epsilon n. So all together, it's at most 5k epsilon n, which is smaller than alpha n. So we covered all vertices except at most alpha n, so which is desired embedding. So that completes the proof. So this was an easy application. Now I'm starting to be worried about the difficult one because we only have 20 minutes now. And so this was easy because of the two reasons. First, the graph we want to embed was not spanning. So that made our life quite easier. We can just throw away small number of vertices as we want. But if we want to embed n-vertex graph, then we cannot do that. So that was the one reason. And second reason was that the graph we want to embed, the H, was totally disconnected. So this is disjoint union of something. So we can just apply Heinel theorem already to find this subgraph of reduced graph. And then we just embed all the things disjointly. We didn't have to consider about the connection. But then we might think that, so what if we don't have those two conditions? What if we have a what if we have a spanning graph which is really well connected? Then it might be not easy to actually do that. But there is some theorem which says that which is stronger than this. So somehow we need this low connectivity condition, but we can make it quite weaker. So for that, let's define some concept which is called separability. So let's say for an n vertex graph, H is eta separable if it contains a vertex at S. Which has size at most eta n, such that every component of H minus F has size at most eta n. So for example, the graph we just considered, disjoint union of cliques or disjoint union of small graph, automatically satisfy this. You just delete empty set, you don't have to delete anything, then already every component has far smaller than some linear size. But also, for other graph, there are many graph classes that satisfy this condition. For example, if you consider tree, always you can find the one vertex which separate into two graph. Both of them have size at most 2/3 n, which is one of the well-known theorem. Actually, when I take graph theory, the introduction to graph theory from Sang Il-eom, one of the, homework problem was this, to prove this. And I used induction to prove it, but he supplied a quite easy solution, which is using some direction on the edge. So I remember it. Anyway, so tree is eta separable for any small eta, assuming this tree is large, the number of n is large. So actually, you need to delete just log n. It's much stronger. For tree, you just delete log n vertices, some constant times log n vertices. Then every size, component of here has only constant size. You can make that. And if you have a cycle, it's not also difficult to show that it is also eta separable. You just delete one vertex and then rest of them is again tree, so you do the same thing. And even if you have a much more complicated structure like square of cycle, which is that you take a graph and then you take two vertices which are distance 2, you add an edge, that's a square of certain graph. So if you consider square of Hamilton cycle, then again, this is separable. Eta separable for any small eta, assuming n is large. So, or you can similarly consider cubic or case power of cycle, and those are all separable. So, quite large classes of graphs are separable. So there is this theorem proved by Bochert-Schacht-Taraz, and which was actually conjectured before by Bolobash and Komlos. So which is theorem 8.6.8 says that for given K and delta and alpha positive, there exists eta and n zero such that the following holds for all n vertex graph with n large. So n is large, and if h is on n vertex graph, with chromatic number k and maximum degree bounded, and eta separable. Then we have a graph G which has n vertex. Which has minimum degree at least 1 minus 1 over k plus say alpha slightly more times n, then h embeds into g. So what it essentially says is that if we add, so okay, so for Hamilton cycle we know that the n over 2 is the degree threshold. So if G has minimum degree at least n over 2, then we can embed Hamilton cycle into G. And Hamilton cycle is almost bipartite, right? I mean, if n is even, it is bipartite. N is odd, it is not, but slightly, because of this one slight incident, it is not bipartite. But we can just say, yeah, let's assume that it is bipartite. Then this says is that, so then this is n over 2, but if we apply it here, then we get n over 2 plus slightly above alpha n. So it kind of implies this. And not only that, if, I mean, it could be more complicated, then we can still do it by adding slight alpha here. So this is quite strong theorem. So, we will prove this theorem in the case H is bipartite. So that's the difficult one that I promised you to. Yeah, I promised you to prove. So how can we do it? So we have H and we have G. We want to embed H into G. So naturally, we want to apply regularity lemma. And regularity lemma, so what was our idea before? We take regularity lemma and reduce graph R, and this R we take a subgraph R prime, which has bounded degree, and which is useful for us. And then we make the edges in R prime superregular. So, we can assume that this number of parts is even. If there is one more, then we just move it to B0. And we take perfect matching in here. So this is bipartite case, so Heinert-Semmeridy theorem is just give us perfect matching. And then we make some modification and we make them superregular by moving some vertices here, moving some vertices here, moving some vertices here. by doing that, still, I mean, this has size, say, 10 epsilon n, so nothing changes. So this, but I mean, yeah, this and this might have a, yeah, anyway, so. And then, still, there are some pairs, say, here, which are epsilon regular, not just super regular. And then, in order to apply Bloch lemma, we have to have a H which has compatible structure with this. What I mean by compatible structure is that we have to partition H into X1, X2, X3, X4, so that between X1 and X2, if there is an H, then we have to have a superregular pair there. And then Xi and Di has same size. The last condition is quite strong condition because, so now we have H and G has exactly the same number of vertices. So in order to get the eject embedding by using Bloch lemma, each Xi and each Di has to have exactly the same number of vertices, which is very difficult to achieve. So lots of the proof later will put a lot of effort to make them have exactly the same size. And H, what do we know? We know that this is separable. So if we delete some parts, then everything is scattered. If it was scattered, then it is easy. But let's say we take W0, which is actually a bipartite graph. So let's draw it this way. So W0. And then we have W1, W2, W3, W4, there is H, H, H. Between this, there is no H, no H, no H, no H. And all of them are small. We can further assume that this A type is very, very small, so that even 1 over R is still bigger than eta. Because eta is our choice. And epsilon, so epsilon is our choice. Epsilon gives us R by Aguilar's lemma. And we see that, and then we can choose eta. Eta is our choice, so we can make it as small as possible. Then for now, we forget about this W0. Then these are very small parts. So W0 is here, but we forget about it for now. And then we have many of these parts. So each has size at most eta n, so the number of those parts is at least eta, which is much larger than so eta inverse is much larger than R. So we have eta inverse many that. Then we can put them so that we have almost same size as Di. So we put, say, here X1, X2, and then we put some parts here, and then next part here. And if this is too big, then when we put it, we either put it here or here, we can choose. We put it so that it has almost same size, and then almost same size. We can distribute it so that this and this have not exactly same, but almost same size. Then if we just embed it to there, then that's Bloch lemma, but that's not enough because we haven't assigned W0 yet. So let's say we assign W0 here. Then that give us, automatically give us this yellow edge. But so assume that this vertex, so this one is in R, this is adjacent to everything. And this 2 is also adjacent to everything. So which means between Bi and here, this is epsilon regular, and between B2 is here, it's epsilon regular. Just for now, assume that. If that was true, then what we could have done is this yellow vertices, and this yellow vertices, which is incident to this yellow edge. If we count this yellow vertices, then W0 has size at most epsilon, I mean eta n. And its neighborhood has size at most delta times eta n, because every vertex has maximum degree delta. So delta times eta n is, eta is small. It's smallest constant except 1 over n. So this is really small, tiny fraction. So this yellow part is very small. And then we know that so as before, this lemma 4 says that if we embed small number of vertices first, and then we consider about their neighbor in this way, then we can extend partial embedding into whole embedding. So in that case, we take all the yellow vertices, and we use embedding lemma first, not just embedding lemma, the more complicated version, so it's in exercise. So embedding lemma, we prove it, and then I mentioned that in exercise, there are more complicated ones, which ensures further condition. We embed that hand by hand here using embedding lemma. Then some vertices are embedded. Because this yellow graph, yellow edge with this, this is also yellow. This yellow edge, if you see it, it looks this way. So this is H. So there is no edge here, no edge here, no edge here, no edge here. So if we just consider this white one, then you can actually embed, because this is sufficiently smaller than this set. This is sufficiently smaller than that. This is sufficiently smaller than that. In that case, embedding lemma says that we don't need super regularity. Just regularity is enough. So we use embedding lemma to embed it first. And then the rest of them, we apply Bloom lemma to embed the rest of them using this additional condition. But we have forgotten one, because even after that, the size is not same. If size was same, then that approach is valid. Also, we have forgotten one more. This might not be complete to everything. Right. So those two are additional things that we have to take care of. So for this, this is not complete. How do we do it if we make a level? So we consider it's here we consider its neighborhood only, right? But we consider its neighborhood and neighborhood of neighborhood. So we consider actually two steps. And then from here to here, there is no direct edge. But we have minimum degree, at least this, in this reduced graph. So if you want to reach from here to here, in two steps we can do. One step we cannot. But we can do it, say, two step. So we take two step, but if we take it two step, then it's not just delta eta n, but delta square eta n, but still that is small, right? So we might have to consider more yellow vertices. And then we embed those into, so we move some vertices around, so we move those into here. So I draw it long, so it's actually drawing this way, so there is no edge in here in H. So this and this, so and let's say we have this and this. So from here to here, there is no edge, we have this and this, and we have this and this. Then we move small number of edges here, and we embed it to actually here, not here. So there is yellow, white edge, and let's say this is two step, then we make further modification. So this, some yellow vertices here doesn't have to be embedded here, but somewhere else. Then we can get this two step into this two step. So by doing that, we can take care of this issue of, these are not complete. But still, there is one more issue that this part doesn't have to have the same size. And even more, because of this vertex embedded to here, the size still could change. Then what we can do, and also I forgot to mention, there is this V0 we haven't touched yet. Okay, I keep forgetting. But this vertex has sufficiently large, so this has degree at least 2 half plus alpha n, right? Sufficiently larger than half. That means there are lots of classes that it has large neighbor. So if it has large neighborhood here, then we can put this into here. Then this is still super regular, and regular pairs are still regular. So we do that for all vertices, we distribute it. And then according to that, we can build up almost same size. Then we can take care of this V0. And then size is almost same, slightly different. But now we use this shifting technique. Yesterday in Heiner's Emoretti theorem, we move one vertex to the other. And we encode that into a digraph. So similarly, we can encode that information. So when can we move, say, one vertex to here? We can move that vertex to here. If that vertex has lots of neighbor here, then we can freely move it here. Right? In other words, if there's white edges here, that means this is epsilon regular. No, just regular. So there are many epsilon regular pairs here we haven't considered yet. These are super regular, we made it. But these are just epsilon regular. Then most of the vertices here has large degree here. So we can move most of the vertices from here to here without destroying any super regularity. So we encode that into this digraph T. So let's say this is V5, V6, and V4. Then 6 to 4, we have this digraph. We can move one vertex to here, right? And then here, we find bunch of passes. Bunch of passes so that if this has 10 more vertices than necessary, and this has 20 more vertices than necessary, and this has -10 less vertices than necessary. And these numbers are all small, right? Because we take it almost same size. How small it is? We can ensure that that's like, 10 to the 10 times, say, eta, something like that. But eta is much smaller, so it is okay. Then correct this and this together. We find a directed path here, from here to here. Then this becomes, and send one vertex, one vertex, one vertex, one vertex, one vertex, one vertex, one vertex. Then that becomes 9, and it becomes -9. And we keep do that. And while we do that, we might have to use lots of number of passes. Say that has r vertices, so maybe r factorial passes, or even more. But every time we add one vertices, so in this point of view, lots of vertices go out, lots of vertices come in. But how many? This time, say this. Because eta is the smallest, this is not big. This is much smaller than epsilon. So we haven't moved too much. So super regularity and regularity are all preserved. By doing that, we can make it exactly same size. And then we embed this yellow part by embedding lemma. And then rest of them we embed by blob lemma using this remark, this remark, this remark, this remark, all remark. Especially the fourth one is the most important one because some vertices, yellow part is already embedded, and when we embed the rest of them, we consider the neighborhood of yellow part, and we specify this x prime widely so that it extends. So actually, my original plan was after this, we start the proof, and then we finish until distribution of V0. That was the first class, my plan. And then in the second class, we do the rest. But time is already over, so yeah. This is the overview of what we will do in the afternoon. This is the class today morning. Yeah, let me know if you have